of the participants and do not reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
BronxNet. Your voice, your views, your vision.
And welcome to Bronx Talk. As part of the Borough President's Peace in Our Streets campaign on October 10th, Monroe College is going to present a special lecture and community discussion on the future of police-community relations. And with ongoing complaints about stop and frisk and the City Council's consideration of the Community Safety Act, we thought we'd partner with the BP's office and Monroe College to engage the dialogue here on Bronx Talk about police and community relations. You can join us tonight by calling in at 718-960-7241. You can also email questions or comments to us at bronxtalk@hotmail.com, and we'll read those on the air during a future edition of our programs. But for now, please join me in welcoming from the Monroe College School of Criminal Justice, and he is also a former NYPD lieutenant, it is Ahmed Tariq. Professor, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
And also from a group called Communities United for Police Reform that just held a protest just last week at City Hall, it's Raul Rodriguez. Mr. Rodriguez, good evening. Thank you for
joining
us.
Good evening. Thank you.
Mr. Tariq, talk to me a little bit about community policing. And you had retired, you had told me, almost a dozen years ago, the difference between the nature of community policing then and now, if there is one.
Well, I'm not really current on what the procedures are now with respect to community policing, but when I was on the job, basically the concept was to have a foot patrol officer on an assigned beat or assigned area. And the idea was to get to know the area, get to know the business people, get to know people in the community, and establish a relationship, okay, in the hopes that people would be forthcoming with information possibly have an impact on crime, bringing it down.
Establishing a partnership.
Absolutely. And in fact, that's the key, establishing a partnership. In fact, that's the whole concept of community policing, a partnership with the community and the police.
This sounds very good, what we hear, and I'm sure Mr. Rodriguez will talk a little bit about, and certainly I've heard from other former officers, and you know, you hear talk from current officers, is that that's not the case right now. Is that right now there are more police officers in streetcars, they're not doing the foot patrols like they used to be. So if you don't have that, and let's talk from the negative perspective, if you don't have that, what is the effect of the relationship, or what is the effect of that on the relationship between police and the people in the communities?
Well, then there's no partnership, okay? Or the partnership is found lacking because you don't have that rapport. It's very impersonal. If police are riding around, there's not the same level of contact. And the relationship is not the same. There's not that closeness. There's no one that they can say, well, Officer Jones, for an example, you know, we're used to seeing him. They don't see that Officer Jones anymore. So obviously there's not that same level of closeness with respect to the relationship between the police and the community.
What was it effective in the time when you were working? Was that an effective way of bringing crime down, establishing that relationship, and keeping people safer?
Well, obviously it would depend on the community, would depend on the officer who was assigned to community policing. Very often, officers, because of attrition, they get promoted, they retire, And if someone takes that person's place, they may not have the same relationship. So I would say that it had mixed results.
Depending on the community.
Absolutely.
Well, we're going to bring Mr. Rodriguez into the dialogue, and of course, if you want to talk about your neighborhood and what, you know, maybe experiences you've had, please don't hesitate to call. What were those factors? Give me an example of a situation or a neighborhood, whether you pick out a specific neighborhood or not, but the type of neighborhood where it would work, and then the type of neighborhood where maybe something else was necessary.
Well, again, it would depend, but I would say. In those areas where an officer would develop a relationship, I worked in the 408 precinct for
which is where
that's that covers roughly between let's say Fordham Road from Southern Boulevard to Webster Avenue, south down to Crotona Park. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
east.
We got the idea.
Okay.
So. And community policing works there? Or
well, there were some areas where it worked. There was a strip, 187th Street. I remember a police officer working that area. And he was very very well known, very well liked in the area. He pretty much did day tours. And you know, he was a fixture. When he retired, I don't even know if anyone took his place. I mean, he had developed such a rapport.
And maybe there was nobody able to take his place.
Correct.
Because he had
Correct.
That personal relationship.
Absolutely.
I'm sure Mr. Rodriguez is jumping out of his skin, dying to have some input here. What's it like now? And this notion is a nice notion. Is it in effect? Does it work? And where are we at from your perspective as far as police community relations?
Well, first of all, I tend to agree on the factor that at one time, there was good policing going on because in the Parchester area where I'm from, I used to have these two officers that was real nice to me, even though at that time I was going through homelessness. They were very nice. One is retired right now, and I do keep in contact with them.
And you still are in touch
yes.
with them? Yes. Very interesting.
And it was good. But, you know, like throughout the years, it has gotten worse by worse when it comes to as far as the relationship between the community and the NYPD.
How do you know that?
Because of the difference between of the procedures that they come across with. Like recently, through these past few years with the stop and frisk, there's been a lot of chaos going on as far as the relationship has been steadily downgrading the relationships between
Talk to me how stop and frisk works to degrade this relationship.
Well, first and foremost, me, myself, and the organization that I represent, which are the homeless people are in the first line of victimization, being victims of this first line of offense because they're always out there. And whenever there's homeless people out in the park or walking down the street, you know, the first thing that happens is that they'll stop them and they'll see where they're going and just because they're homeless.
It makes them an easy mark.
It makes them a very easy target mm-hmm. because selective policing happens in my area at a lot of points. Like if I, like one example, like if you see a man walking his dog and he's pretty well dressed, they want to undress him to see what he's doing there as far as a homeless person sitting on a bench.
They might, but they would be less likely to do so than if in that other circumstance.
Yes, of course.
That would certainly make sense. And do you hear a lot from homeless people and from other people that they're being harassed?
Well, accordingly, since I'm the chairman of the outreach for the Civil Rights Committee in Picture the Homeless, I go out and I do a lot of outreach. I reach a lot of people, and I've had a lot of homeless people, plus formerly homeless people, give testimony of the facts of their experiences with the NYPD on how in some cases they were even thrown into the ground and arrested for trespassing for just because of a stop and frisk. And a lot of these people right now are currently in civil lawsuit suits, mm-hmm. okay, especially in the 161st area.
And so what this does, and I'm just going to infer based on what you're telling me and from what Professor Tariq said, this breaks down this bond or this interrelationship between the community and the police because everybody wants to stop crime. The question that I want to ask is about the pressure on police officers to make arrests. CompStat has been a pretty strong crime-fighting tool and an intelligent way of approaching crime-fighting. But does it go too far? And officers now, in the circumstance that we just heard, you know, because we need to make an arrest. So, you know what? I got an easy mark. He's somebody who's semi, if not fully defenseless. I can just take him down and issue him a summons, and all of a sudden my numbers look better.
Well, absolutely. But I think what's key is training and supervision. Okay, I think with proper training and proper supervision, incidents like what Mr. Rodriguez just described don't happen as much. Okay, I think there's a breakdown when supervision is not foremost, in the forefront, okay?
Is there good supervision right now? I mean, I mean, I think we can all imagine how things could be, but hearing an overwhelming number of complaints, I'm guessing that supervision is not that good.
Well, you know, that's certainly a factor. Supervision would be a factor. Training would be a factor. And then, of course, the area we're talking about. If it's a high crime area, obviously there's more pressure to bring these numbers of arrests up. Okay, so that is certainly a bigger factor, you know, within the large scheme of how policing is done. Is it a high crime area? If it's a high crime area, then certainly more aggressive tactics are going to be employed to bring that crime down.
But if those tactics are aggressive and they're not quote unquote community friendly, are you then going to ratchet up, in other words, the tension in the area, as opposed to, well, find ways to bring it down?
Well, again, you have to bring the supervision that becomes a factor again, because you can still be aggressive and not compromise the rights of people.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Rodriguez, let's talk about this Community Safety Act, which your organization is totally behind, which is in the City Council now, and I know you're hoping that it will pass. You had, I mentioned it earlier, a protest at City Hall. The idea of racial profiling, this would be something that would be prohibited. Tell me about it and how it would take effect and how it might help this idea of community policing.
Well, the Community Safety Act, first of all, is compounded of an act of four different bills. And Intro 800 protects New Yorkers against discrimination by the NYPD, not only within the factor of whether it's gender or housing situation, but also in other factors, being race, creed, and it will.
So they couldn't do, say, well, you know, we want to check you out or we want to stop you, unless they had real justification, and it would be prohibited by law as opposed to by inference or suggestion.
Yes, of course, because basically what happens is that now you're starting to curve down what is called the selective policing, okay, with this act. And A lot of other states have laws that are similar to this, just like West Virginia and Arkansas, where they found it to be a very good tool in this matter.
Let's bounce it off Professor Tariq. If in the high crime areas that you talked about, and maybe there are more aggressive tactics being used, if this sort of a bill were to come about, and I'll just throw out on behalf of Mr. Rodriguez and his group some of the other things, protecting against unlawful searches, requiring police officers to identify themselves to the public, including a little business card that says this is how you file a complaint, creating an inspector general's office. Will this, as Commissioner Kelly says and the mayor says, break down their ability to fight crime in some of these high crime areas?
Well, I don't think so. I think the police
department... So you're for it. You like this reform.
Oh, absolutely. I believe that it might build public trust in the police department, okay, especially because, see, it's not just racial profiling. I think it also has to do with class, okay. And I think that what happens is poor people are affected by this, all right. And I think that they may feel that, okay, well, maybe this is a good thing. They may feel that that their rights aren't being violated as much, okay, and they may feel more inclined to cooperate, perhaps even give police information, because the police would be more user friendly.
You know, I'll just interject, and then we're going to go to the telephones. When we had Borough President Diaz here, and I talked to him about guns and the problem of guns, which, of course, every one of us wants to see how we can take guns off the streets, one of the things he said directly was, you know what, and I forget which shooting that he talked about specifically, but he said everybody in the community knew who did that, and yet the police are knocking on doors. There were people who witnessed it. We know there are people who witnessed it, but we can't get anybody to come forward. That... The suggestion was, and the suggestion has been with like Communities United for Police Reform, because of the breakdown of trust. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely.
All right, let's go to Lily from Allerton Avenue. Lily, nice to have you with us. How are you?
Yes. Good evening.
Hi.
As a council president, I've been in PSA 8 as a president for the last 12 years. And I'm telling you, all these senseless murders with shootings unnecessarily because of the lack of the fact of the resources that the PSAs, the police service areas have, the bureaucracy. Time and time again, I have gone to several city council hearings when it's come to public safety, not only for the housing developments, but overall as a people, as a community, as different communities in all five boroughs. Mm-hmm. And I tell you that there's a very displeasure with the way police are having the opportunity because of the limited resources, the funding.
When you say resources, you're talking about numbers of officers or some other resource that is unavailable out there?
I'm talking overall. I'm talking of the fact that I have been in the ins and outs of talking to one police plaza and those hierarchies to telling them that we need to cut the bureaucracy and the political.
Explain to me what kind of bureaucracy gets in the way of crime fighting.
The fact is that we have four developments that was under the watch of PSA 8 that no longer are part of the police service area 8 because now they have been put with the precinct. The precinct has to be able to be retrained. I said that tirelessly with Eric, Schaefer, with every commissioner that has been put in place. There is racial profiling, unfortunately. There is a stigma when it comes to our communities, but we can't put excuse about because we're poor or whatever area that we're from. This is about strength in numbers. And people need to hold themselves accountable, putting NYPD and the mayor accountable.
Got it. Lily, thank you very much.
They're not impacted by our communities overall.
I understand.
And that's the big issue.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Rodriguez, talk to me about the inspector general, the notion of an inspector general that comes out of this Community Safety Act. What would potentially that do in this process?
Well, what it would do is that first and foremost, the New York City Police Department is the only department in the United States that does not have an inspector general, okay? And having
the
inspector...
The only one in the United
States. And now the thing is that what we're trying to do with having an inspector general is that it will give an overseeing sight on the accountability and transparency of what are the procedures that the police do, okay? And if and when they do something that's wrong, the inspector general could take care of the action accordingly. As far as other departments where it would just turn around and you would just shift them from one place to another.
Well, although, ironically, I mean, that adds a layer of bureaucracy, which was something that Lily was not happy about. Now you're adding another layer on top.
Well, it's not putting like a layer on the top of it. It's more like putting more accountability of what they do. So like that when they go out there and they do their job, they'd be more aware and more consequential of what they do.
Because there's somebody or some entity out there. CCRB is not sufficient?
Well, the thing is with CCRB is that it does have some kind of effect to one matter, but with an inspecting general on top of it, it will be a more intense and a more allowable sense of criteria when it comes to policing the police, so to speak, is putting more of an oversight on all these matters.
You know, when what we hear from NYPD, what we hear from Commissioner Kelly and the mayor is that if you take away an officer's ability, unfortunately, to evaluate somebody and says, well, this is a high crime area, that person is of color, or, you know, the percentages show those are the people who commit the crimes. If you take away our ability to look at those people more seriously, frankly, then you're going to hurt our ability to fight crime. You agree with that?
Well, I think you have to look at how effective it's been. Okay, if it's been effective, then okay, that's one thing. But if it hasn't been effective and the community is constantly outraged about the results, then you have to take another look at it and be open to other suggestions, other ideas that will bring the community and the police together. Now, in some communities, all right, this is not an issue. All right, and we have to ask ourselves why. All right, is it a racial thing? Is it a class thing? Is it both? Both these factors are involved. I think, you know, at the end of the day, it has to be looked at again, and things have to be used that work. For an example, I grew up in public housing, and at a young age, tenants organized among themselves and took turns at establishing a tenant patrol. Mm-hmm. Okay, this had an impact on the living conditions in that, but now this was one building.
Well, we have talked about this on this show, and we've had a number of people who run tenant patrols, and we know they work. I guess my question, and maybe we'll start with Mr. Rodriguez, and then we'll bring you in again, Professor. Are people and communities less likely to establish tenant controls in the climate that we have now, where they distrust the police because there's no sense of interaction? My guess, based on what we've been talking about, is that right now, even though we hear that it's an effective method, they're not really going to do that because they don't see that partnership. Is that true?
Well, the thing is that first and foremost, the CPR, we do have a community-based cop watch. All right, where we go to certain neighborhoods, and we have a lot of personnel doing it in neighborhoods to watch over the police as they're doing their procedures.
See, you're talking about watching over the police. Yeah. That's a little bit different from what Professor Tariq was talking about.
And the thing is that the reason why I say that is because if we get to the terms whereas, like he said, if there's a lot going on as far as the public stating that there is something wrong, so then we're trying to find a way and how to correct it. And one of the factors with the Community Safety Act is concerned is that it brought forth not only the awareness to the public, but also has put the public to participate in certain factors so like that they could be able.
Let me ask you something. If you know that a neighborhood, and I'm not going to pick out any neighborhood in the Bronx, but the numbers show that this neighborhood has got a problem, whether it be guns or whether it be robberies of stores or whether it be burglaries, you know, whatever it is, or even more serious crimes. You know, murders or rapes, and the numbers clearly show. You tell me how you're going to stop and lower those numbers if you're telling the police officers, you know what, we don't want you to stop and frisk, we don't want you to racially profile, we're telling you we want you to be nicer, yet police have a very difficult job to do in that neighborhood. How are you going to bring those numbers down?
Well, I'm not condoning the fact that they do have a difficult job to do. But there's a procedure of what you go by and to doing it. And putting a whole mess of innocent people in the way of how they do things when there is neighborhoods like this is something that not only is appalling, but it needs to be stopped. Because just because of a few bad apples doesn't mean that two or three barrels have to suffer the consequences, mm-hmm. in other words, so to speak.
Professor Tariq, I'm throwing that same question to you. Here you are, Mr. Commissioner. We've just ordained you commissioner. Mm-hmm. If you have that circumstance where you know that this community has a problem, and yet we're telling you, and in a way I'm saying you're putting the police with their hands behind their back, you can't make judgments, you can't make snap judgments, you have to follow more stringent procedures. How are you going to bring crime
well,
down?
Well, you know, I wouldn't even attempt to try to answer that question. What, what I would say, though, is that, you know, I think the public, you know, has to be more involved, okay? And I think there's existing programs or ways that the public can get involved. You know, you have the precinct community.
Let me just interject if I can.
Sure.
That's actually a very good answer to what I said. You say, right. You know what? Then don't put the police and isolate the police and make them do it.
Correct.
Say it's a problem
because
of all
you
the
have,
people
you have,
the,
you have
the
existing,
lawful
you have existing things in place. Every precinct has a precinct community council, okay, which the public, which the residents of that precinct can attend on a monthly basis. Mm-hmm. Okay, you have that as an outlet. You have the auxiliary police program, okay? These are ways where public and the citizens can get involved in having an impact on crime.
Mr. Rodriguez, do people in Bronx neighborhoods, number one, utilize those sufficiently, and number two, even respect those organizations because it comes out of a department that they don't really have trust for?
Well, in a lot of ways, because even with the NAACP and things like that, these are organizations, along like with CPR, where they do a lot of work as far as educating and helping out the community as far as what to do as far as their rights are concerned, mm-hmm. and how to go about it in a very democratic way, is very vital so like that the relationship between the NYPD and the community could get back together. Mm-hmm. The whole point that the CPR is concerned as far as with the Community Safety Act is that, number one, we need to have that relationship back. We need to have what is called that professionalism, that integrity, that respect back between the NYPD and the community. And if we could work together on that, it would be great.
While we're talking, Jane, I want you to put up the information because we want to continue this dialogue at Monroe College on October 10th. We have that information so people can come out and have this same dialogue, but you can have your say as well as have a couple of experts talk to people. Let's just kind of wrap it up in that vein and say, okay, you've got the community wants to know, the community wants to have their rights. In the long run, how do you rebuild that trust that you had when you were a police officer in the city of New York?
Well, I think, you know, as I mentioned, you know, you have to get involved, okay? How bad do you want to have that partnership?
You're right? Talking about the people in the community.
People in the community. How bad do you want that? Now, obviously, the police, you know, every police precinct has community affairs officers, all right? They also do crime prevention, mm-hmm. all right? These are resources that the public can take advantage of, okay?
And so what you're saying, we're just about out of time, but what you're saying is people shouldn't lay back. They should do, frankly, what Mr. Rodriguez and his colleagues are doing and saying, you know, we want to take control of the streets
Absolutely.
And work in partnership.
Absolutely.
I'm guessing that that's your
Absolutely.
Bottom line.
Yes, of course.
Establish a partnership. Gentlemen, we're out of time. We thank you for the dialogue. We want you to continue that dialogue at Monroe College on the 10th and really in our communities and neighborhoods. Professor Ahmed Tariq from Monroe College and also Raul Rodriguez from Picture the Homeless and the Communities United for Police Reform. Thank you. And folks, if you have further comments or questions on anything you heard on tonight's show, or anything going on in the borough of the Bronx, then email them to us, thebronxtalk@hotmail.com, and we'll read those on the air during a future edition of our program. Archives of Bronx Talk are available at bronxnet.org. You click Bronx Talk on the right-hand navigation bar. Also, please become a fan of Bronx Talk on Facebook. We put all our little notes in there and the previews in there. Now, please make a note, in 2 weeks, we will celebrate our 18th anniversary on Bronx Talk with what should be a really special and fun show, a lot different than the tone of this one. On that night, former WNBC sportscaster Len Berman will be our guest. We'll talk sports and also about his new book, which is a sports book designed for young people. It's the anniversary of Bronx Talk, October 15th, and we'll have one of New York's most beloved sports personalities, Len Berman, with us, so we hope you'll join us. Should be a lot of fun. The gorgeous new set was custom designed for Bronx Talk by BronxNet's Gene Elton, based on the original design by Bronx artist extraordinaire Danny Halbin. And we thank Jane, and we thank Sean, and we thank the cast of thousands here, and we thank you. Good night.